Good evening, everybody. My name is Bert Dicht. I am Managing Director of Membership for the National Space Society. And on behalf of my colleague, Larry Ahern, Vice President of Chapters, I'd like to thank you for joining us for this evening's Space Forum. The new guys, the historic class of astronauts that broke barriers and changed the face of space travel. As always, thank you for joining us in our series of space forums and town halls. We appreciate the support and taking the time out of your schedules to join us for these informative sessions. In terms of our agenda this evening, we always discuss some virtual etiquette, a few NSS announcements, what's coming up with the space forums. We're going to get then right into our program. And also at the end of the program, we're going to be giving away four copies, autographed copies of the new book, The New Guys, but you must be present to win. So hang around, obviously. We'll make sure we do these things very fast. In terms of our virtual etiquette, it's best to submit a question using the Q&A function. That is easier because it's seen by the panelists and we can just pull that directly, but you are free to use the chat function as well. I encourage everyone to be respectful of our speakers and the rest of the audience. And we did get a number of questions that were submitted beforehand, and we're gonna try to cover as many of those as possible, along with your own questions that you submit this evening. And like always, we sometimes will have a chance to turn on the microphone and have you ask your question to our speaker directly. As always, I encourage you to give to our cause. If you're enjoying programming like the space forums and town halls, please donate to support NSS. Your past support is very much appreciated, and I'll thank you in advance for any future donations going to a good cause, so thank you. And I will post the link in the chat. Also, please complete the post-space forum survey. It only takes a few minutes. It'll come up as soon as you exit the session. It's anonymous. And as I said in the past, it really helps us in planning these events and making sure we're putting on programs that are of value to you. A reminder, I know we had a great session last week on the International Space Development Conference 2023. So I just wanted to remind everybody that is coming up very, very soon on May 25th to 28th at the Embassy Suites in Frisco. Great sessions, as you can see, on moon, space settlement, interplanetary infrastructure, space development, many roads to space, Mars, and so much more. We've got retired astronaut Bonnie Dunbar and a real treat, Jared Isaacman, who will be commanding the Polaris Dawn coming up. Dr. Pascal Lee, who was with us last week and gave us a great preview. Dylan Taylor, Dr. David Livingston, Janet Ivey, and many, many more. So we definitely encourage you to make that trip and join us for the ISDC on Memorial Day weekend in Frisco, Texas. Hope to see you there. So what's coming up? We made a decision the other day to not put any space forums on in May. We've got a lot going on with the ISDC. There's a lot of planning and prep. Just to make it a little easier both on us and any potential speakers who also might be speaking at ISDC, we're gonna postpone our programming until after the ISDC. So we'll see you in June. As I've shared before, we've got a number of great speakers lined up, and we're looking forward to having a great program for you once we get through the ISDC. So we'll see you in June after this session. So now let me get right into our program for the evening. And our topic is, again, it's a brand new book called The New Guys, and it's about the 35 new guys, the space shuttle astronauts who were selected in 1978. And it is a great read. So I definitely encourage you to pick up the book, but you're gonna be hearing firsthand about it this evening from the author, Meredith Bagby. Meredith is a nonfiction writer. She's a partner in Big Swing Productions. It's a film and TV production company. company. She's got a number of previous books that include We've Got Issues, Rational Exuberance, and the Annual Report and of the United States of America. She was a senior film development executive at DreamWorks SKG. She's been a political reporter and a producer for CNN and a teaching fellow at Harvard's Institute of Politics. And her education includes Columbia Law School and Harvard College. So we're really pleased to have Meredith with us this evening to talk about a really important step in our nation's space program and these 35 new guys. So Meredith, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Oh, Bert, thank you for having me. I'm excited to talk to everybody. As you mentioned, the New Guys is a project I've been working on for many years, since 2017, and it just came out in February of this year. I'm a Florida resident. I grew up in Florida, and I've always, not so far from the Cape, always been aware of the space program and NASA. And, you know, I first got interested in NASA when I was just a fifth grader. My teacher, Tom Sarko, down in Palm Beach, Florida, applied to be the teacher in space and in the 80s. And of course, he didn't get it, but Christy McAuliffe did. But he was one of the finalists in Florida. And we spent that year learning about NASA, learning about the shuttle program. And then, of course, when Challenger launched in January of 86, I was one of millions of kids who saw the Challenger explode. I was out on an athletic field. And it always made, obviously, a big impression in me, like it did so many others. And when I got the opportunity to learn more about, the people who had died on the shuttle, and in particular, the other astronauts, and the fact that four of the people who died on the shuttle on Challenger were part of this historic class of astronauts in 1978. And it was the first time they were the first class, which included women and people of color. I just became really obsessed with the story, and I felt like I had to tell it. So that was really the impetus for, the book. And it was initially conceived of as actually a television show. At the time, I had just started a production company with Kira Sedgwick, and we were looking for good ideas and new heroes that hadn't really been showcased before, and, you know, came across this. And initially, it was conceived of as a TV show, but then, as I began to do the research and contact the astronauts themselves and hear their stories, it very quickly became evident that, what we really needed to do first was write the book. And, while there is terrific, there was a terrific body of material about these astronauts out there, there wasn't, a narrative in the way that, this book kind of reads as a narrative. And what we wanted to do, or what I wanted to do with this book, is, you know, tell the history of the space shuttle and tell a lot of the technical aspects, but also tell a more human story about the astronauts themselves and make the book accessible to people who weren't space fans, you know, who maybe just wanted to pick up a book and read it on the beach. And we wanted to make sure that we reach that group of people by telling it in a very narrative way. So, Bert, I don't know if now is a good time, but I can, one of the things I thought would be fun to do is show you guys the trailer I cut before I wrote the book. And it's not so dissimilar from what ended up being kind of in the book itself, but it's a fun trailer. And it's also the thing that we use to sell it to Hollywood as a TV show. Does that sound okay?
Yeah, that sounds great, Meredith. Yes.
Okay, great. I'm going to share my screen. And let's see here. I'll pull this up. Let's see, desktop. I guess here we go.
Just remember that little share the sound too.
Yeah. Okay. So this was the original trailer. I hope you guys enjoy it.
15, 14, 13.
Firing chain is armed. Go for main engine start. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, engines up and burning.
America's first space shuttle.
I want to get up as soon as I can. So that means that I'd like to be the first woman up.
I thought, wow, when I grow up, I could be an explorer of the universe.
What happens when you meet a man who's not in the space program and doesn't know who you are and you say, I'm an astronaut? Does he say, yeah, you're too cute to be an astronaut. Come on, little lady, you can't be an astronaut.
When there was a problem, when there was a funny, a glitch or whatever, how did you respond? How do you take it as a human being? Do you weep? What do you do?
Why doesn't anybody ask Rick those questions?
We look forward to launching from the Cape, first of all, and returning here a few days later.
And liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Engines at 65%, three engines running normally, three to fuel valves.
The Challenger crew was pulling us into the future, and we'll continue to follow them.
We didn't fly again for almost 3 years, but worse than being grounded, we lost 7 good friends.
I realized that we could continue that mission for them. And I looked to the heavens and promised that I'd do everything to do that.
Lonnie's gonna go in space shuttle, and this is our last night home.
But it is absolutely gorgeous. It's sometimes hard to get away from the window and go back to work. Don't you cry
no more. While I was up there, I felt like that's where I belong.
So that was, now how do I stop sharing? Oh, there we go.
Yep.
So anyway, that was the trailer. We cut it in 2018, long before the book was written. And the idea, was that we wanted to show this group of people who became friends and had a lot of fun together. And we wanted to show, the couples, the people that fell in love, and the tragedy, of course, of the Challenger, and how this group was able to come back from that, and the real human aspect of the shuttle program, and particularly of this class, which was so historic. So I'm happy actually to pause and open it up to questions, if Bert, if that sparked anything.
Sure. Well, let me start with one question. When you were thinking about it as a television show, were you thinking it as kind of a documentary, or more like in the format of From the Earth to the Moon, where you would tell their stories as a kind of real life, but fictionalized in that sense?
Yeah. That's a great question. And actually, you know what I realized? My Vimeo kept going. Sorry. We initially, it's interesting. What I really thought of, I thought both of those could be great containers for this, and maybe they still will be someday. But I think we were initially thinking of it as a series, much like Chernobyl. It was a series with that is purely narrative actors and the whole thing. And the reason was, as there's a lot of, I think there is a lot of, you know, I actually thought the Challenger documentary, The Final Flight on Netflix, was great and did a lot of the work that maybe this kind of thing would have done. But what we wanted to do, or what I still hope to do, is have a narrative where you get to see these intimate moments of like people falling in love and the competition behind behind trying to be first, the first woman or the first, person of color to space. And we wanted to capture those intimate moments in a real narrative way with actors. And that's still the plan, so.
Yeah, sounds good. So the idea started in 2017, as you were saying, and with the idea for a TV show, but you transferred to the book. So when did you actually start working on the book?
So from 2017, I started doing some pretty intense interviews with the new guys. And then by 2019, 2020, right around the COVID years, sold it as a book, and then got really busy with putting all the pieces together. And so it was really, the writing of the book took about 2 years. But the researching of the book, and we did like hundreds of interviews with the new guys and the NASA administration that were there during that time. And that went on for, 5 years, something like that.
Now, in terms of writing the book, what did you find was probably one of the most difficult aspects of it all?
I think the most difficult aspect of it all, and I think that this had to do, this kind of played out in the writing of the book, in the selling of the book, and the selling of the TV show, and in actually reaching audiences, was the cast of characters is so large. And there are 35 new guys, and we wrote about a lot of them. We focused on the 10 interesting people, as Kathy Sullivan calls them, which were the 6 women and the 4 men of color. And, having 10 main characters ends up confusing a lot of people. And even me, and I was writing it, I was like, how do I tell the story of all of these 10 people and give them, the page count that they deserve, but not confuse a reader and still orient and still tell like a cohesive story. So I think that was the toughest part.
How hard is it to just out of nowhere call up an astronaut and say, I'm writing a book, would you talk to me?
Yeah, it's funny. I got used to it because my old job was that, and I was a journalist. And so I'm used to cold calling people. And my friend has a comment or a phrase called no is my hello. So it's the idea that, it takes a while to make people feel comfortable talking to you and that you're not some weirdo and that you're a safe place to tell their story. And honestly, that takes years. And that's why a book like this takes so long.
Can you give us a sampling of some of the astronauts you actually spoke to?
Sure. The first person I think I ever called and talked to successfully was Anna Fisher. And I ended up for sure talking to her the most during the course of the book. As you know, she's just a lovely human and very approachable. And she loves to talk about her time at NASA and her career. And so she was very generous in terms of the time she gave me. I went out to Houston and met with her a few times. And we've become friends, and she's just terrific. Fred Gregory is so much fun. A lot of this happened during the COVID years, so a lot of our meetings were over Zoom, but I got to know Fred well. Kathy Sullivan is so sharp and so smart and can talk about nearly everything. I like to say that Kathy speaks the way most people wish they could write. And Ray Seddon is awesome, also really fun, lives down in Tennessee. Guy Bluford was a lovely person to talk to and has a great intellect and memory of the things that happened, including his first flight, the first flight of an African American to space. So those were some of the people that were instrumental. I mean, Shannon Lucid is also fantastic. I really love talking to her. Anyway, I could go on and on. And the last person I'll mention is George Abbey, who I went out really early. I went out and had lunch with him at Frenchie's, which is the, in Houston, it's the kind of the hangout that's not too far from Johnson, where they all eat Italian food, a very heavy, creamy Italian food. So I did that with George a few times.
George, I'll ask this question ahead of time because you mentioned George Abbey. George Abbey's kind of a thread through the book. For those who might not know who he is, can you just tell us a little bit about George Abbey and his role?
Yeah, George has had one of the longest administrative roles at NASA, and he started during the Apollo era. He himself actually wanted to be an astronaut and applied to be an astronaut, but was rejected by Chuck Yeager during that period of time. But he went on to become the Astronaut Maker, which is the title of his biography, which is a great read too. And he ended up being the one who chose the new guys. The first class of astronauts that he chose was the new guys. And he was coming in and he recruited them. He was coming into that role for the first time. And then he remained the flight director for many, many years up until I think a year or two after Challenger. And he was the one who chose all the astronauts and he chose who would fly when. So he was incredibly powerful. And he had this kind of mysterious quality. They called him the Godfather. He had kind of this mysterious way of doing things that sometimes infuriated the astronauts. They would never know if they were going to be chosen until the moment they were, and nobody ever knew how he did it. And so anyway, he's a larger than life character at NASA and a delight to have gotten to know.
Very good. Well, you mentioned earlier about the first class, including female and minority astronauts, but this class also separated pilots and mission specialists. And so that's a big mix. How hard was that to integrate into the existing astronaut corps?
It's interesting. It's there was a lot of resistance prior to the new guys' arrival. And there were other women, including the Mercury 13, who tried to get into the program years before that in the 50s and 60s. And it didn't make it. And the same can be said of Black pilots, test pilots, people who tried to come through Chuck Yeager's school. They were denied entrance for this or that reason. And so finally in 78, the Civil Rights Act had passed and things were changing and Congress forced NASA to integrate. It wasn't their choice necessarily, but once they did integrate, and once they did open the program to civilians and women and people of color, and those people got recruited, they did separate out mission pilots, as you said, and mission specialists and pilots. And one of the reasons they could do that, this is a long-winded answer, one of the reasons they could do that is because the shuttle was very big and it could take not just pilots, but it could take also this other group of people who were scientists and they could do experiments in space and so forth. Anyway, so they had room to have mission specialists. But of course, the mission specialists were a totally different crop of people. The pilots were these, your typical right stuff, adrenaline junkies, the people Tom Wolfe wrote about who had dreamed of being astronauts their whole lives. And the mission specialists were a mixed bag. Some of them had dreamed of becoming astronauts. Some of them actually wanted to become physicists or geologists or any number of things. And the pilots were people who had flown in Vietnam often and been in the war, and the mission specialists were people who had protested the Vietnam War. So they're culturally very, very different. But what's great, I think, about this class is they were able to integrate and learn from each other. And not one of them dropped out. All of them made it to space. And many of them had extremely long careers. Anna's career, as an example, spanned the entire length of the shuttle program. So a really incredible success story.
Just a follow-up question that was submitted. That did you find anything in your research that supported evidence that some top NASA brass did not want the six women picked?
Yes. I mean, I think the big one was Deke Slayton, which was very well documented. And he was, as I understand it, the research I did, he was part of the selection committee and walked off the selection committee because of it. So I can't imagine a lot of people would raise their hand and say, yes, I did. But he's one that I did find that, and I found that a couple spots. But I'm sure there were more. I think the fact that NASA didn't do it until 1978 and that Congress forced them under congressional oversight indicates there was probably a lot of internal pushback.
Was there anything you found in your research about that? Because I'm just wondering, you know, NASA has a certain public image and sometimes we think, oh, they're open, they're innovative, but when it truly came to diversity, they were way behind the curve. And, you know, just wondering how it affected the astronaut program and the overall space program.
Mm-hmm. I think it probably affected it more in the 60s and the early 70s than it did. By the time the new guys got there, they were ready. I think they were ready to accept the women and the men of color that they hired. But I think prior to that, there was a real resistance. Ruth Harris, we talk about it a little bit in the book, but she was the head of HR at that time. She's an African-American woman. And she was publicly fired. She got, and that actually spurred a congressional investigation into her firing. And then she was rehired by NASA as a result of it. So there were, and she, you know, the idea was that she in her role as an African-American woman and as the HR was trying to push for these kinds of things. And she was meeting a lot of resistance, from the NASA officials, who were her bosses. And so, you know, there was a lot of evidence that it was very difficult to try to make this happen, before Congress stepped in.
Wow. There are a couple questions that popped up about training of the astronauts. And so was the train, and this was a question from Carl, was the training for these 35 ASCANs different than previous training for, you know, the Apollo astronauts and so on?
Yes, it was. And I think it was different because the shuttle was different. And the shuttle, the forces that people felt on in the Apollo capsules or in Gemini were different than the shuttle. And I think in some ways, I guess the shuttle was like a luxury liner compared to some of the little tin cans they shot up before. So you didn't have to do some of those very rigorous, almost like torturous trainings they didn't have to do anymore. But they had to do other things, you know, like as an example, you know, the spacewalks were probably a little different. They had to learn how to maneuver around the shuttle, on the shuttle, to fix the shuttle. And so a lot of the underwater training was, I think, a little different. You know, the exit systems were different. There was so much that was different about the shuttle. I think what was interesting about their training, though, was it didn't exist when they got there. George Abbey and Jay Honeycutt and, you know, Chris Kraft, they had to kind of make it up because the shuttle didn't even exist at that point. I mean, it was in prototypes, but it wasn't flying and it had many, many difficulties, technical difficulties it was still undergoing. And so how do you train on something that doesn't even exist yet? And they had to make it up as they were going. That's the truth. And so so Guy Bluford and Anna also told me, she's, you know, that they felt like their bosses were winging it at times. And they all had to kind of bootstrap the program into existence because it didn't, before them, there was nothing. And which is so exciting and also kind of terrifying. So.
Did any of them say, wow, what am I signing up for? They don't even know, you know, they're not even sure how to do this for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think they did. But I also think, most of them also say, look, I would have flown, you know, a corn cob to space. I would have flown, you know, they were so excited to be astronauts. They didn't care what was taking them, but they were going to make it work.
Right. You do have some candid responses in the book from the astronauts, but there was some stories about a couple of the ASCANs who didn't know how to swim. And, you know, how tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, that was my favorite, one of my favorite scenes to write. So Ron McNair, who was from the segregated South, and he was from South Carolina, and he grew up at a time when swimming pools were whites only. And he was Black, and he couldn't go, and he never learned to swim. So he came to the program. Of course, he didn't tell anybody he didn't know how to swim, and nobody asked. And so he shows up on his first day of water survival training, and I'm sure he was panicked, knowing he was going to get dropped in Biscayne Bay and dragged through the water on the back of like a speedboat. And so he bonded over that with Ray, who had also grown up in the South, very different upbringing, white, you know, upper middle class background, went to, you know, was a debutante, but didn't know how to swim because she had had an incident with a young man who held her head under the water and terrified her. And so she never got in a swimming pool after that. And so she was also terrified of being dropped in Biscayne Bay, and she didn't tell anybody that she didn't know how to swim. Anyway, aside from water survival training, was pretty much the first thing they did. They had to go out there and do that. They still needed to prove they didn't die that day, which was good. But they still needed to prove that they could swim, and they could dive underwater and pick up bricks, and they could tread water. And they had to do that because a lot of the training was done in underwater, and they had to be scuba certified and so forth. So the two of them got together, and they went after hours to the swimming pool, and they taught themselves how to swim. So I just love that story, because it also shows, like, here are two different people, you know, back in their hometowns, they would have never known each other. And here they are, like, learning this basic skill together and bonding.
No, it's a great story.
Yeah.
Yeah. These are all incredibly highly accomplished individuals. You know, how did they deal with the competition to be the first? As in your video, Sally Ride mentions about wanting to be first, and and so that had to be very competitive.
Yeah, it was, and I think it's interesting too, because we're coming up on Sally, on the 40th anniversary of Sally's historic flight, and of course there was a lot of interest in the first woman. Who would be the first woman? I think everybody knew whoever she was going to be Neil Armstrong, John Glenn, you know, she was going to be a household name. And so I think, you know, the choice of who was going to be first really lay in the hands of George Abbey. And he was the decision maker. And so the women couldn't help but constantly measure themselves and try to understand whether or not they were doing well or doing poorly in George's eyes. And some of that was the work, and some of it was social. You know, George had he loved the softball games, and he loved to win. He loved for the astronaut office to win. So playing softball on George's team was an important component. Well, some people thought was an important component of how you were doing. And you know, Sally was a great athlete, and she was shortstop. And so, you know, so it was, did that put her over the edge? You know, there are all these like little, when you're in it, I think they were all kind of, they said that, you know, we would obsess about it, who was winning. And, of course, you know, there were so many interesting things that happened. Like we told one story of, well, just to back up for a second, one of the most important ways people could figure out whether how they were doing was what kind of jobs they were getting at NASA. And what they reasoned was, if you got a job that was close to a first flight, a job that was required on one of the early shuttle flights, maybe that was an indication you were doing better. And so the robotic arm, I don't know, like was the Canada arm. And everybody knew that was going to be on one of the first flights. It was going to be on one of the first flights because it was going to deploy a satellite, and they wanted to test the technology. And all of a sudden, Sally is the first person who gets put on the robotic arm, and she's sent up to Canada to train. So people are thinking, oh, maybe Sally is going to, you know, she's going to make it. And then some people think, well, spacewalks are really important, and I'm getting trained, I'm getting a spacesuit, and I'm getting trained on the in the water. And so maybe that's important. But what was interesting, and it ended up being the robotic arm that was so important. So she was sent up, and then Judy Resnick, who was also a very qualified candidate, was also sent just after her to train on the robotic arm. And so that was an indication potentially that maybe Judy was also in the running. And you know, what I found was that the it feels like the competition came down to Sally and Judy based on this robotic arm and based on this choice that George made to send them up there and to train. And then I also heard that once they got closer to making the decision, Chris Kraft then sent Anna Fisher up. And this isn't in the book, but this is just sort of a fun story. Sent Anna Fisher up to train on the robotic arm because Chris Kraft really liked Anna and thought maybe she should be first woman. So it's interesting that this robotic arm, which is sort of a weird detail, but not so weird a detail because it ended up maybe determining who was in the running. So it came down to like those three women, I think, in the end. And, you know, between Judy and Sally, Judy did not like the press. She was very private. She shut people down pretty quickly, reporters. She didn't like, and so it ended up, and we found some interesting, like we found some memos that talked about that, some internal NASA memos that Judy was not good with the press. And then it very clearly became Sally's game, because not only did she know how to do the robotic arm, she was athletic, she was fit, she was good with the press. And it, to us, that was the reason she was chosen. So that's a very long answer to your question. But
it was interesting in reading the book, as you said, Sally was good at it, but it also seems she was reluctant. If she could have just done it in obscurity, she would have been happy as well.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a great observation. She had a very complicated relationship to fame. She wanted to be great at her job, and she wanted to, in some ways, be renowned, but she was very uncomfortable with being famous, being looked at, being chased after, being expected to do certain things. And of course, after her flight, she had a very hard time dealing with all that press and ran away and stayed with friends and really tried to manage and keep a private life, which was very important to her.
Right, right. I want to get into, I know we want to talk a lot about Challenger because you cover that pretty extensively, but what about the impressions that they had of John Young? John Young was always my favorite astronaut. So just like to see the impression that he had on these 35 new guys.
I mean, it's hard not to be impressed by John Young and his career. Actually, one of the people I got to talk to a fair amount was Bob Crippen, who flew with him, obviously, on the STS-1. And everybody just had a tremendous amount of respect for him. They also commented that he wasn't a manager type, that he wasn't somebody who really enjoyed the HR aspects of his job and was often kind of awkward in leading the meetings, which I find funny because I think he's like, in all the videos I've watched of him, he's very funny and very, very enjoyable. But while many people commented, including Mike Mullane in his book, that he was staring at his shoes and he had a hard time communicating and he had a hard time being in front of an audience. He was an engineer at heart. I think the other thing that's so interesting about him is a lot of people talked about John Young's memos, that he was always bringing up safety issues. He was always really concerned for the astronauts' safety and for how they were being treated. And then he was very insightful in terms of some of the technical challenges that the shuttle faced. That's just some of the stuff that I've heard about him. But.
Right, right. No, I remember seeing him with Bob Crippen on the Phil Donahue show before their flights. And Phil Donahue was just gushing over them and then makes a comment, boy, if I'm ever caught stuck in an elevator, I want you guys with me. And, you know, John Young said, you know, just in his dry wit says, I don't want to get stuck in an elevator. And I just happened to see Bob Crippen at an event and I asked him about that. And he laughed and he said, oh yeah. And then about 2 months later, they got stuck in an elevator in Washington.
Yeah, I did hear that. That's funny.
So let me see if some questions that have come in. So a lot of activity here. And one question about your book, is there going to be an Audible version of it?
Yes, it's on Amazon. Yes, it's on Amazon. You can get it right now.
Oh, great. Okay. Yeah. Okay. We got the question about the difference in training. This question, I believe we've kind of covered it. It comes from Grant, but maybe you might want to add a few things. What was the culture of NASA like in the late 70s when these astronauts were selected? Did the culture of NASA need to change at the time, coming from an era of white male fighter pilots to a more diverse group of astronauts?
Yes, it did have to change. And I think it's interesting. I think the new guys were like, what do they say, moving through a cobra? Like they were a huge group of people that they did change the culture almost immediately. The moment they stepped in, they changed the culture. And just visually, it's so interesting looking at their class picture compared to all of the class pictures that came before. Not only were they the biggest group of astronauts at the time, but they looked totally different. They didn't have buzz cuts. You know, they weren't adrenaline jock. They were wearing dresses and turtlenecks and jewelry, and they had sideburns, and like they looked like they were kids of the 70s, which they were. And just immediately, I remember Sylvia Stoudemire, who was one of the administrative assistants, was like, it just the minute they walked in, the air changed. And I think that's true. I think before that, it was sort of an all boys club, and now it couldn't be that anymore. Yes, I think it changed. and then it never went back. I mean, it was still always, heavily male and heavily white, but this really started to change things in a big way.
So it was a combination. You had a whole new space program with the shuttle, but NASA changed internally as well. So mm-hmm. for the better.
Yeah.
Let's see. I've got a question. Good question from Thomas. You mentioned about the 10 interesting people. What were the biggest challenges the 10 interesting people faced in becoming the new guys?
It's a great question. I think what's, I'll talk about the women first. I think the system had never had women. And as a result, a lot of, just as an example, like they weren't prepared for women, like the equipment wasn't for women. So as an example, when the women tried to use the spacesuits, they were way too big. And I remember Anna telling me the smallest spacesuit was Pete Conrad's. And so that's the one all the women used, but it was still like awkward and weird. And they didn't get spacesuits for women until much later. Even when they did another example was when they did the water training, they didn't have a lot of women doing water training back in those days. And so the parachutes and all the equipment was too big. And Ray tells us a hilarious story where she jumps off the back. So they were doing parasailing. She jumps off the back of the boat. She gets taken up by the parasail, but the parasail is too big and everything's awkward on her. And it kept going up and up and up. And she was like, I'm going to go into the ether. I'm not going to make it back. But it was simply because the equipment wasn't made for somebody who was 100 pounds. So there was a lot of things like that they had to like deal with. The rescues, the escape systems, some of the women had trouble using because it requires more upper body strength. So they had to rethink that. And so there were a lot of things like that just about women's bodies and that they were not prepared for. Those were kind of the big things. I think in terms of like the African-Americans, nobody ever said anything that they felt that there was any racism at NASA or that they weren't treated unfairly. I think socially, sometimes people hung out in groups and maybe people didn't always feel included in some of the social aspects. But I think with regard to NASA, I think by 1978, they really made an effort to kind of make this class work, and they knew they had to. So I think even though there were some challenges, there was nothing that felt unsurmountable.
Right. I know Mike Mullane in his book is very candid about his reaction initially to female astronauts, and he was not happy about it. But in the end, he said, I was totally wrong. And these were, these are accomplished, fabulous colleagues. Did that surface in any of your research and discussions with some of the other astronauts?
Yeah, I think so. And I think Mike was very honest. I mean, that was brave of him to be that honest in his book about how he felt. I think there were other people, he doesn't name them, but he talks about other pilots who were tough on the women and made like kind of nasty jokes. And, you know, there was one incident, I think, you know, Kathy Sullivan told me about where Chuck Yeager kind of dressed, they were trying to introduce her to Chuck Yeager and like, oh, this is new pilot. She's, you know, learning the T-38. And he's like, oh, she's not flying. She's riding. Like, you know what I mean? He was very dismissive of the women and their ability to fly these, you know, planes. And, so yeah, there was, there was. And by the way, some of the pushback that the women got were from the wives of the male astronauts who didn't love the arrangement of the men flying with these nice, like good looking female astronauts in T-38. So we're paired up with them. And, you know, look, I mean, things happen. People did fall in love and people did get divorced and remarry. And that was part of it too.
Right. Right. Since you opened that up, you mentioned a couple, you know, Ray Seddon and Hoot Gibson and Steve Hawley and Sally Rod. Of course, Anna and Bill Fisher were married before they became astronauts, which in itself is pretty extraordinary. So tell us a little bit about some of that.
Well, like, as you said, those were the couples that kind of emerged. And it was funny because some of them ended up being T-38 partners. They were the ones that were flying together. You're like, oh, and then they fell in love. And so, so all of that happened. And I know, you know, Sally also, I think, dated Hoot, hilariously, and then dated somebody else, and then ended up marrying Steve Hawley. So there is this sense of nobody knows us like this group. Like, how could you understand what I'm going through? How could anybody understand what I'm going through other than these people? And so it made sense to me that they ended up making friends and falling in love with each other.
Right. I'm going to take another question from Donald. He says, in the first three groups of astronauts all graduated at or near the tops of their classes, were the eldest or they were only children and were high achievers. Did any of the eighth group fit that profile?
That is a good question and one I did not ask those astronauts, but I would imagine. I mean, it does seem to be, I guess if the question underlying that is, are they, you know, type A, then yes, they were all very type A. Really good at school, really fit people, you know, really... people who knew what they wanted, and whether or not they were first children, I'm not sure.
Yeah. But yeah, they're all kind of, you know, overachievers in a way, as you said, you know, Sally Ride with the PhD in physics, but she was could have been a competitive tennis player, for example.
Exactly. And Judy, you know, was somebody who was top of her class and also a piano player, like a concert level piano player. So they had multiple, I think that was interesting, you know, and George talks about this too, is this idea that they were good at many things and well-rounded and, you know, the perfect college applicant potentially. But yes, all very type A.
Right, right. Got a question from a good friend of mine, Tim. He wants to know if you have any plans for a KSC area book signing.
I do, actually. I think I'm going to be there in mid-June. I don't have the date yet, but around June 17th, something like that. But I'll put it up on the website.
Very good. So why don't we talk a little bit about Challenger? I found your coverage of the Challenger was, you know, you had a lot of great detail, but you also provided or presented it with such respect to the astronauts who were lost and their families. And how difficult was it to write that part of the book?
I think that was the most difficult part, for sure. And I was right before, I mean, up until the part that the editor was just like taking that out of my hands, I was still writing it. I was still writing certain parts of it that I felt like needed to be dealt with a lot of care. And, you know, I wanted to get it right. I didn't want to get any detail wrong. So we were very, very careful about that section of the book. And I had it, you know, I had the NASA historian read it a couple of times. And I had a lot of people read it to make sure that it was all very accurate. And we were representing what had happened in the accident in an accurate and fair way. And also who knew what, which is still up for debate, but I wanted to try to present that and at least if, you know, source it also as best as we could. I think what ended up being really interesting and also new in terms of what people have talked about in the past is the Challenger recovery effort and I was lucky enough to talk to a couple of people who were really there, and they gave me like eyewitness accounts, which I don't think I certainly hadn't read before or heard before. And so that felt new. And also I was tried to be very, very careful about how we wrote that section too. Mindful that these are people that, you know, people are still grieving over. To your point, it was very, very difficult to write.
What was the reaction of some of the other astronauts as they learned about some of the decision-making that was involved in the Challenger, that it was clearly a flawed decision to launch? A very preventable accident because they just didn't act on something they already knew. And did some question whether, hey, do I want to still fly on this thing?
Yeah. It's a great question. There were, I think what was so shocking to me too, I mean, I had heard about O-rings and I knew that there was a fault, that there was a fault in the administration. What I didn't understand was how many times, how many near misses they had and how many times O-rings nearly failed prior and how many astronauts who both died and didn't die for instance, the example would be L. Onizuka, who died in Challenger, but almost died in the flight before that. In the flight before his flight before that, which was a Department of Defense flight, the O-ring came very close to burning through. And it was his flight that initially caused Morton Feickel, who was the manufacturer of the O-ring, to create this task force to look at the problem of the O-ring. So Ron McNair was on a flight where there was an O-ring burned through before Challenger. Judy Resnick was, and on and on. And I think, Fred Gregory, who was not on Challenger, his flight also. And I think Fred was one of the ones who, after Challenger happened and after it came out that the O-ring had been this consistent problem, and after he realized he almost died on a similar kind of a flight, was extremely vocal about the fault. And, I think he was punished a little bit for how vocal he really was. But Fred's still angry. You can still, when you talk to him, you can tell. And a lot of these people are still very angry. Some people chose to leave, some people chose to stay, but it was a mixed bag in terms of what people ended up with at the end. I mean, some people, like Anna as an example, ended up taking time off and having a kid. Sally left the agency entirely. Fred stayed, Anna eventually came back. But anyway, there was a lot of different reactions, yeah.
Was there anything that you learned during your research that maybe either surprised you or disappointed you about the whole Challenger accident?
I think the fact that it had happened so much. I mean, that was really shocking, that the O-ring problem was something that they lived with for a really long time, that they understood what the problem was, that there was kind of a cost benefit analysis done where to solve the problem would have cost a lot of money and taken the shuttle off the launch pad for a really long time, which ended up happening anyway. That all felt, I'm sure, it had been reported at the time, but it was certainly something that I missed. And just having to confront that and do the research around it was very staggering. I think it was very shocking.
There were a couple of questions that were submitted about the shuttle program overall, and maybe talking to the astronauts, people were asking, was the shuttle program worth it? You know, we lost two crews, 14 people, and, so, in how do the 35 new guys look back on it and say, you know, this was worth it or not?
Yeah, I think they think it was an immensely successful program. Despite those losses, they flew 135 times. They carried and helped stitch together the International Space Program. They launched Hubble. They launched so many of the satellites that are still up there. They proved that regular folk can go to space, not just pilots. They showed that diverse people could go to space. There are so many wonderful things that came out of the shuttle program. I think I also agree with them that it was a huge success. I think those losses, I think what's difficult and also heartening is that those things could have been prevented. And perhaps, you know, we learn from them, you know, in terms of how administrations are run, in terms of how we think about safety. But even though those losses were very tragic, I think the people who were lost understood that what they were doing was very risky and that there was this big risk that came and they were willing to take that risk. I think they understood. So as tragic as it was, I think everybody, and of course, after Challenger, most of what people said was, let's go back. They didn't say, let's stop.
Right, right.
Yeah.
A couple other questions that came in, and then I'll get to my last questions as well. Carl asked, did romances ever interfere with performance in the program?
Not that I'm at liberty to say, no. I may know about a few things, but I didn't write about them.
right, okay. And Christina asked, and this is a good question, I noticed that the trailer used the bleeping new guys.
Yeah.
And that's been dropped in the book title. What was the phrase, you know, was that the phrase used by the old guys or is that your phrase, Meredith?
that was a phrase. As I understand it, it's a military term. The F and new guys is a military term for the lowest grunt in the group. And it was applied to the new guys, but they respectfully renamed themselves the 35 new guys. so they didn't, but that is the original name of the class.
Oh, great, great story.
I took it out for obvious reasons. Target and Walmart did not want, No, it wasn't an appropriate title for the book. So.
Right, you know, I can see that on a bookshelf.
Yeah.
Let me just scroll down and see some of the other questions here. Question from Jeffrey. After all of your experience with people in the space program, what are your personal views about the value of the space program? What it should evolve into? And if asked, would you like to ride into space? Would you like to be the first journalist in space?
Maybe if my kid, when once my kids get a little older and they can survive without me, yes. No, I am a big proponent of the space program. I think it's awesome. I think NASA is awesome. You know, even with all of its flaws, it's a pretty tremendous achievement, what we do. And I'm really excited about Artemis. I can't wait to see Artemis 2 launch. I can't wait to see what happens with Artemis 3. I can't wait to see what happens with the Chinese space program. It's all pretty fascinating.
Let me go back to someone you've mentioned a couple of times in our discussion. Carl asks, what role did Chuck Yeager have in the program? And I think people might be interested in hearing a little bit more about what his role was.
Mm-hmm. Well, he predated the new guys. And, you know, he's written heavily about in Tom Wolfe's book, The Right Stuff. But he ran the test pilot program, which trained the first astronauts and became a kind of de facto astronaut maker back in the day. That role kind of subsided as the shuttle came about and the new guys, came into play, that his role was replaced. You know, George Abbey honestly became the person who selected, but he was a gatekeeper for many years in terms of who was going to become an astronaut and who wasn't.
Right, right. Let me see if there are a couple other questions that were in the chat. I just want to make sure I try to get everybody covered. Okay, a question, a comment from Bill, the Rockwell engineer who was the no vote for Challenger accident, told me years later that it would have that they had no information on how it would work under those circumstances and recommended they not do it. Okay, so just a comment there. And let's see, another comment from Janine, I think here. Given the explosion today, we can see that space is dangerous and risk mitigation is as good as it gets. When we start mining and manufacturing in space and launch from space itself, we can minimize the gravity problem and the power needed to escape it. Okay, just some comments that people had, okay. And let me get to a few others. I think someone has raised their hand, so we will definitely let him ask a question. But in terms of the 35 new guys, you talked to them a lot, you did a lot of research. How do they see themselves in terms of history and their role in contributing to the overall space program?
Wow, that's a great question. I think, at least I can tell you how I see them and how I think they see themselves, which is, I think that to me, they were the beginning of modern space travel. And when I think about modern space travel, I think about people who were not just military guys, but regular people. They weren't regular. they were very type A. They were very successful and very brilliant. But what I mean by that is that it's spaces for everyone and people, you know, regular people, women, people of color, everybody can go and everybody should aspire to go. And I think they were the first people who did that. And so I think to me, that's where they hold a place in history. And I think they see themselves as that too.
Right. When you're talking about, you know, spaces for everybody, was there any resistance initially to the plans to take, like, you know, Bill Nelson went up and the senator, I can't remember, Jake Garn went up and then of course, Krista McAuliffe and the teacher in space. So just wondering, you know, how they felt about that type of thing, about non-professional. Yeah.
It's really good. You know, many people felt that those decisions were, I won't say frivolous is not exactly the right word for it, but they were pressed like a press stunt. They were a stunt in order to get funding, in order to please, you know, somebody, in order to, you know, win a news night. And they felt, as many felt, that they were dangerous. And I think when Challenger happened, those people felt they were proved right, you know, because, you know, what were we doing saying that space was not risky and sending this teacher up? And they were very angry about it. So there were people who were very resistant to those kinds of things. And the truth is, the shuttle was an experimental vehicle, even after all of that, you know, and it was very dangerous. So.
Right. I think I saw a hand up. Carl, did you want to ask a question? I can allow you to talk. I see your hand is down again. Does anyone want to ask a question to Meredith? And I can turn on the microphone. Okay, I don't see any hands coming up. Oh, there it is. Carl's got his hand up. Okay, Carl, I'm going to allow you to talk. And just remember to unmute. Oh, you're still muted, Carl. There you go.
What's that?
There you go. Perfect. We hear you.
Oh, okay. Okay. Hey, I'm wondering, do you think NASA should consider for a future space program the idea of developing reusable spacecraft for the future?
I think that's a great question. We've certainly gone back to a different model than we had with the shuttle, you know, in terms of Artemis. But in terms of, the difficulty, it's interesting because the difficulty with reusability is, at least with the shuttle, they felt like they were going to save money, but then the amount of money it cost to refurbish it each time and the stress of reentry was so big that almost was, you know, the design became very problematic and much more expensive than they thought. That was true both of the shuttle itself and of the, you know, the solid rocket boosters, which they ended up having to build these big boats and like go out and pull these things out of the ocean. And then they were all messed up and they had to. So it's interesting because we think reusable, but then we do have to spend a lot of money refurbishing these things. And are you saving money and aren't you saving money? I think it does come down to cost. And are we able to develop the technology to make something actually reusable? And I don't know the answer to that, but I know that like they kind of gave it up after the shuttle because of some of the pitfalls, you know, they thought they could save things. They thought they could refurbish things, but it ended up costing way more than they ever thought.
So it all comes down to cost, I would imagine then, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know the answer to that. I know that there's been a lot of studies on different types but I think what they came to the conclusion was better to just start over again.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'm wondering if you were thinking about joining a future space settlement.
Sure. Let's see what we get. Yeah.
Let's see, a couple more questions have come in. And let's see, Janine asks, what outreach activities are the space elders involved in to support the new space programs? And how effective are they? And are there more students pursuing space careers? I'm not sure if you can answer that question or not, but I think we can.
Yeah, maybe you guys can do. What are the space elders doing? I know that like Anna, as an example, still keeps in touch with like Victor Glover, who's going to be up on Artemis 2. And like they serve as mentors, I think, too. And there's a really strong astronaut alumni program where it's like they get together and they serve as mentors to the new astronauts. Most of people are like officially retired at this point. I hope that answers the question. I don't know.
And just a quick question about Anna Fisher. That's one of the things I didn't know about was, and you mentioned it in the book, that she was good. You know, she actually did ran the space station development program and was offered a chance to fly to the space station. And then, of course, Columbia happened.
Right.
And did she ever think about going back after that?
Yeah, I think she felt like the timing, she had missed her moment, that she, you know, there was a moment where she would have done it. I think you're right. She was training before Columbia and she was working on her certifications. And I think after Columbia, and by the way, she was actually on one of the commissions, I think, that investigated the decision around not trying to save Columbia. And I think just after that, she just felt like she had missed her moment, you know, and she wanted to focus on other things.
Right. It looks like in one of the comments there, you've got an invite to go to Australia. So,
all right. I love that. I've never been to Australia.
So we'll download that soon and see if we can do something about that. Yeah. A question for you that I was thinking about as I read the book, and you know, what's your ultimate message about the book? You know, what were you trying to accomplish with it?
That's a great question. I think I wanted people to know about this extraordinary class. I wanted them to connect to them emotionally. I wanted people of color and women and girls to be excited about the space program and see that they have a place in the space program. So it was really an effort to like lionize and canonize these extraordinary heroes and, you know, encourage people to be interested in space and science, including my own kids.
You chose a different path. Were you ever thinking about science yourself and a STEM career?
I think, you know, I was. For some reason, I didn't have the horsepower in the sciences that I think, at least at the time, that I thought I needed to have. And so I ended up going into journalism instead. And I was a lawyer for a while, I have to admit. So I went into the social sciences instead. But no, I did. I took a chemistry. I took a college level chemistry class, and I was like, yikes! I maybe don't have it. This is maybe not me. But I love writing about the sciences, and that's my fun is from the sidelines and as a journalist.
No, I know you're in the book. You're telling a human story, but you're also telling a technological story. Did you have to read a few things over? Did you have to do some extra studying to address some of these things? Yep.
Yes. I feel like I put off dementia for another couple of years by learning about solid rocket boosters. No, but it's really fascinating. I actually love that stuff and I love trying to make it. So one of my jobs was, I was a writer on economics. And so I love trying to take like very complicated systems and kind of make them understandable for people. I think that's a lot of fun. Yeah. But yes, right. Rockets it's a very challenging moment. Yeah.
Obviously you can't fit everything into the book. Is there anything that you really thought was fabulous, but you just didn't have space in the book for that maybe you'd like to share with us?
Oh my God. Well, this is a story from Jim Bajan, who was on the Challenger recovery. And I guess they got really tired. Jim and the other guys got really tired of the news poking around. And they basically, there was a raptor, like a bird that landed on their boat. And they pretended like the raptor that they had found, they pretended like they found the Challenger itself, but used a code word, the raptor. And then I guess the press went off and said, they found it. And then they delivered this raptor, to the CBS guys as a joke. Anyway, that was kind of like, it was kind of like a weird story that I wanted to fit in there, but I didn't have room for it. So.
Right. No, fabulous.
Yeah.
Let me see if there are any final questions and then maybe we can get to our book giveaway. Let's see. Carl, did you have your hand raised again? Did you want to ask another question?
Yeah, let's see. Yes.
Okay, go ahead. You'll get the last question.
Oh, thank you. Hey, I'm wondering, why didn't Chuck Yeager become an astronaut?
It's a great question. I think Tom Wolfe writes about it in The Right Stuff. I'm pretty sure he does, but I cannot remember the actual reason.
He didn't have a college degree.
Maybe that's it. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
I think you're right. I think that is it. Yeah.
Also, yeah. Chuck Yeager disparaged these people. They're just riders up there. They weren't in charge of. They weren't driving that rocket.
He mentioned that a little bit.
Yeah, he mentioned that in The Right Stuff.
Oh, I see another hand is raised. Let me see who it is. Let's see. Nope, the hand went down. Well, very good. I think with that, Larry, a question.
This one, at one point like this, he said, you and Meredith said that they like to go in space. He says, when I was in the service, overseas like this, all of a sudden, I said, sergeant, come up to me. Come up to our group and say, okay, who's the FNGs, that's when I seen this here thing and I said, it brings back not so fond memories at the time, but in retrospect, they were fond memories. But just thinking, if you go into space, you are going to be the FNGs.
Okay. On that note, Meredith, just thank you so much. That was really fun and enjoyable, and we learned so much. And your book, I read it as soon as it came out, just to let you know.
Well, thank you. I had such a great time, and all these questions were super insightful. So I really appreciate it, and I appreciate your audience.
We've got a great group of members and audience. They're very knowledgeable, and we have a great time with these space forums. So let me get to the. Book giveaway right now. And so everybody, what I've done is I've created a list of everyone who had registered, and I'm using a random number generator. So I will pick a number, I will get a number and then go to the list. And let me just call that list up right now. Okay, let's see. Just got to take a second here. Oh, there it is. I've got it. Okay. So I'm going to go down and use the random number generator and we'll get the first one. So that's number 18. So is Kerry McCormick on? You could just drop a note in the chat. Kerry, are you on? Let's see. I don't
see. She's not here. I don't see.
So it doesn't look like it. Kerry, if you can just put a note in the chat.
No, she's not here. There's no McCormick or Kerry.
Okay, I'm gonna choose another one. Very good. Let's do it again. Okay. So this is number 37. And let's see, that's Joan Raelick. Joan, are you on?
Yes, she's on.
Joan, oh, yes. Joan, I see you're on.
Yes.
Very good, Joan. We'll get you a copy of the book. Very good. Let's go and do the other one.
Yeah, Joan Raelick, right from my
another generation. Okay. She's from the
Chicago area.
This random generator works very well. Okay, this one is number 79. Richard Kasich. Richard, are you on?
Yeah, he shows up on here, yes. He's still on.
Gotcha, Richard. So we've got Joan and we've got Richard. Those are two of the books. And we got two more to go. Thanks, everybody, for being patient. And that one comes up now, number 16. I'm just going to find who that is. Chris Shaben. Chris, are you on?
I don't see.
Okay, Chris, just put a note in the chat if you're on.
What's the last? How's the last name with S?
Okay, I don't see Chris responding.
Oh, she's not on here.
Let's do one more. Susan Razor. Susan, are you on?
Yes, Susan, Long Island. And yes, she's on. Susan?
Yep, Susan, we got you. Perfect. Okay, one more book to go. And okay, one last time. That's great. And Frank Garza. Frank, are you on?
No, he's not.
Okay, I don't see Frank responding. We'll do one more.
Well, we told the people that they have to stay on here. Like, we lost about 15, 20 people near the end here. Okay.
Michael Young. Michael.
Yes, he's here.
Mm-hmm. Got you. Okay, fabulous. We got our four door prizes. So thank you all for that. Perfect. I like doing it in real time. I might have saved time if I had just done it beforehand, but We'll be getting you. I'll be reaching out to you and following up so we can get the mailing addresses that you need, and we'll get you those signed books. And there was a question in the chat about where people could get the book, Meredith. So
that's what I was just about to ask.
Available in most places.
Yeah, it should be any bookstore, Amazon, Barnes and Noble, whatever you like online. It's looks there. Like
are you muted?
Oh, I don't think so. Can you see? Oh, maybe I'll put it in the chat.
Is it besides hardcover? Is it electronic on Kindle?
Yes, Amazon or Barnes and Noble or your local bookstore. The hard copies are still there on Amazon. So or your local bookstore.
Is there a Kindle copy? That's somebody just asked if there's a Kindle copy.
Oh, Kindle? Yeah, it's on Kindle.
Okay, good.
So if you just type in my name or the new guys on Amazon, you'll find it.
Okay.
Very good. Anything more, Meredith, on the TV show? Do you see that eventually happening?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think I can say we're working with Steven Spielberg's production company to put something together.
Wow.
So that's where we are right now. More to come.
Fabulous.
Yeah, we're about to have a writer's strike here in Hollywood. So we'll see how that shapes up. But we'll keep our fingers crossed.
I've heard that. Yes.
Yeah.
So, well, very good. I just want to thank you one more time, Meredith. It was a great presentation. Thank you for answering all those questions. I know we covered a lot, and I definitely encourage those interested in the 35 new guys and the space program and the astronauts to pick up a copy of the book if you did not get one this evening. So again, Meredith, thank you so much. We really appreciate it taking the
Thanks
time
so
out.
Thanks so much. I loved it, and I hope to come back when we have a TV show.
Oh, we'd love to have you back. Absolutely, sounds right. Good. And so I would just like to close out by again thanking my colleagues Larry Ahern and Fred Becker for all their support in putting on our space forums. For those of you who joined us this evening, thank you again. I hope you enjoyed it. Remember, we are not meeting again until June. We will be sending out messages about when the next meeting is and who the next speaker is. So we'll make sure you get that information. So take a little time off. And of course, hopefully we'll see you all at the ISDC. So I'm going to sign off. For those of you in our time zones, wishing you a great evening. For those in tomorrow's time zones, have a great day. And for everybody, have a great weekend and stay safe out there. So thanks, everybody. Thank you again for joining us.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, Bert. Bye. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Larry.
I'm just going to stop.